Good evening, and welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity and to this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Now, since that time, we have established brand schools throughout the United States and various parts of the world. The Ontario brand school was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names for the Heavenly Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word of Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. And we now know each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in the alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible rendering for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We've drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the creation abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word of Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in the divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifests himself in the physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given up salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of his name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Now, after Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and court roundabout. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Also in the school, we go forth to prove that everything in the creation, in the universe, moves and operates according to structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now the 10 primary constitution objectives or aims, this is as follows. Number one is to help you find the Yahweh or Elohim as it really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, modern practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is 1 Peter, 3rd chapter. And our scripture reader will be Dr. Ken Weeklingson.
Good evening, class. It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for allowing us to be here and have another chat in you. Beautiful and wonderful teaching that you give us. Thank you for through the seven angels you send, Henry Clifford Kingley. And keep revealing things to us. You are merciful to us, and you are our Redeemer. We are conscious of that. I say all those things in your only Son, name Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible, reprinted by Yahshua Promotions, 1 Peter 3. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the conduct of the wives. While they behold your chaste behavior coupled with fear, whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold or putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of Yahweh of great price. For after this manner in the old time the holy women also, who trusted in Yahweh, adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him sire, whose daughters you are, as long as you do well, be not afraid of any terror. Likewise, your husbands dwell with them according to knowledge, giving honor unto the wife as unto the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers be not hindered. Finally, be you all of one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous, not rendering evil for evil, or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing, knowing that you are thereunto called, that you should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let him see peace and pursue it. For the eyes of Yahweh are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of Yahweh is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you if you be followers of that which is good? But, and if you suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are you, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify Yahweh Elohim in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear. Having a good conscience, that whereas they speak evil of you, as of evildoers, they may be ashamed that falsely accuse your good behavior in the Messiah. For it is better if the will of Yahweh be so, that you suffer for well-doing, than for evil-doing. For the Messiah also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to Yahweh, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit, by which also he preached unto the spirits in prison, which formerly were disobedient, when the long-suffering of Yahweh was waiting in the days of Noah, while the ark was a-preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls were saved by water. The symbol of which even immersion doth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward Yahweh by the resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah, who is gone into heaven and is at the right hand of Yahweh, angels and authorities and powers being made subject unto him. That was 1 Peter 3, that is all saying.
Thank you. It's good to see everybody here tonight. And this is Tuesday night, our workshop night. And our first speaker and instructor will be Dr. Will Williams.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's good to be here, good to see y'all here. You know, to learn more about this great, this great panoramic vision that's been bequeathed upon us by Yahweh through our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley. And before I get into whatever doctrinal subject we get into, I just want to take a few minutes out for some comments. As we make a historical leap into the, into the future. No, see, we have a new camera here today now, and see, and we're making a transition towards live broadcasting. You know, see, because for 20 years we've been recording our classes continuously. 20 years, seriously, we've got stuff that goes back. I mean. wow, you can see what I look like, you know, before I got dreads, and how terrible I used to dress before a certain person gave me some advice. He's laughing at me because he knows what I'm talking about. we even have her husband on tape. That's, you know, first time I ever met a popping Jay.
What?
A popping Jay. Yeah. Anyway. But that's the story of Ontario class, and we have it on video. For example, just recently, you know, we had been using tapes, you know, mini DV tapes, because that's what we did, you know. 10 years ago, that was good technology. Now it's obsolete, okay? Simple as that. All right, that's the way technology is. But at the time, it was great. Before that, we used VHS tape. In fact, we still got a few around here. Yeah, we got a couple right over here. Yeah, so if you're here, this is, let me see here. I had my glasses. That's terrible now. See, that's, I gotta wear glasses now. Okay. Oh, wow. You wouldn't believe it with this tape. See, this is a tape right here. You can even look at it. And I'll try to show it to you on the camera if I can. And, I don't know, can you read it?
Blurred. Gotta focus. Probably too small.
Yeah, it could be. Oh, why don't you just zoom in? Try that. How's that?
That's a little better. Yeah, you can read it there.
Okay. You can read it. Because it says, let's see, this is 10-29-06. Mm-hmm. And it's got, Ignacio Ramirez and myself, and the lecture's called Pope of Rome and Likened to Cain. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But that was in 06. That was over 11 years ago. Mm-hmm. And actually, it's three lectures on here.
Yeah.
That's true. Three lectures. That's how we used to tape. We used to put three lectures on one VHS tape, 2 hours a piece, and it's super long playing mode. it made for poorer quality, but more storage because it was cheaper, you know, that way. Certain times, certain cases, we were able to make, you know, SP type tapes, you know, for quality, you know, like certain places I went, things like that. But anyway, but still, yeah, we have it, 20 years. Basically, we have 10 years of lectures on VHS tape, and we have 10 years of lectures on DVDs. That's pretty much, almost pretty well evenly divided. And then also interspersed in that is places we went to where I videotaped. Like, we went to New Jersey that one time. I videotaped that. We went to Tampa, Florida one time. They had a thing, and we videotaped that. We gave a seminar once. And was it 05?
Yeah. 03.
Oh, a seminar? No, it was 05, I believe.
July 24, 2001 to 2004, 05.
05, yeah. Yeah, so we videotaped that. Yeah, places I went, like when I visit a class, I videotaped it if they let me. I videotaped a Plym retreat once, Dr. Lee Warren, 2000 Plym retreat. I videotaped that. I got that somewhere in the file. Just a lot of stuff, you know, that we've done over the years, and so now we're making this transition. And when we make this transition to live broadcast, it'll probably be the end of me recording videos, for DVDs, because we're going into a format, and it's just getting hard for me to do this. And I've been doing this for 20 years. Can you believe that? 20 years. I sit back and think, I was like, 20 years, and I go back and look at the tape that I have them. He's over my place or over her place, and I put on the table, I'm like, man, it's like a window into the past.
Yeah.
You know, and it makes me remember the day, that day, when I was like, wow, you know, I remember. I remember that day. Because it's on video. And, you know, and I was the kind of guy, you know, I always get the snippets afterwards, you know, I don't just stop at the lecture, I just get, you know, and because that's part of life. And then I look at the things, the way we were, you know, what we looked like, the people who were around then, mm-hmm. you know, who passed on, and yeah. things like that. I mean, it's, man, it's awesome to see it. It just, I don't know, maybe one day, I hope that's my desire, is that to make this library, this vast library of Ontario class available somehow. You know, I don't know how. I mean, I know LeBron said he's taking upon that task, you know, so I don't know how he's going to do it, but for more power to him, that's all I can say, because I did it for 20 years, okay? But it was a pleasure, because I was moved by the Spirit to do so, you know, and I have to also thank someone. I have to thank Keno Wayne, because she's just as much a part of it. Because when we yeah. started off, it was her equipment we started off with.
Yes.
She donated the cameras, and you know, and the VHS recorders that we used to dub with. In fact, there was one time, because we sold, you know, you could buy the VHS. At one time, it was kind of really supporting the rip pretty good for a minute there.
Yeah, sure was.
For some surprising reason, I don't know how, but it was. And yeah, and so it's a record. It's a record of Ontario class we have, and I don't know what we're gonna do from that point on. I just say let Yahweh just show us. And look, for me, you know, whatever things I learned in school or whatever, I just try to apply it here, you know, in the way, You know, we shoot and what we and we're all something else. I want to really give you guys some kudos on what you guys did. What was it, last Friday when you played Dr. Kinley, man? That was a bomb. That was a good thing. I wasn't there that night, oh. Folks. Okay, but, you know, and really it balanced out a bad tape. The tape was bad and the audio was spotty, and even for the Kinley lecture. So that's why I kept texting everybody, what was the lecture y'all did? Because then what I could do, what I did do, was I put it in my editing bay and I edited that out and I put in a clear tape. Now, I couldn't salvage Joe's lecture, although, you know, I pretty much know what he said, you know, but the lecture, because the audio was spotty because of the tape, but that won't happen tonight because we're not using a tape. See, we have an SD card now. So, but that's what happened. But anyway, but that was a good, man, that was good what y'all did. One, in the playing of the Kinley lecture, also what Lloyd did as far as he was listening to what Dr. Kinley was saying, and he zoomed in on the certain charts that, yes, that he was, you know, that he was talking about. And that, and people picked up on that. People saw that, and that, it was really, you know, it was really great. You know, so, and that's the whole point about being a camera person that I'm trying to impart and instruct. It's not a cookie cutter thing when you shoot somebody on the floor. You have to assess the whole situation. You know, look at the situation, assess it, and then just make a proper choice on what to frame. See? And shoot, because you're doing the editing right on the fly, and whatever it is that you decide that the frame and shoot is what's going to go on the disc that's going to be uploaded.
See? How many hits?
Huh?
How many hits?
It's got, last time I saw it, it was over 50. And like several likes, maybe about 4 or 5 likes at least. So, a couple of comments. Oh, that reminds me. Pass me my phone behind you. It's in my pouch. Yes. Right there. If I can get it, because I have a message for Dr. Samuel, to be honest with you. Yeah, we're just taking a time out here, because we want to address you folks out here. And as we do go to live, I was thinking, you know, because we like to interact with you folks, and we still have our conference call. Like, if you ever look up the number up there, the conference call is on the board up here. Yeah, go ahead and show that while I'm... Looking for this, and when we go live, we'll still be doing our conference call. So maybe we could maybe have some sort of setup, an arrangement where somebody could be, online, and they could, if somebody want to ask a question out there while we're live, then they can feel the question, and then we could. Feel the question, and we can just deal with it. Dr. Samuel. Yeah, I have a message for you, sir. I mean, you don't have to read it out loud, but I'm getting it so that you can, that you can read it for yourself. Somebody saw your video, and they were really inspired by it. And they just simply reached out. And that's Dr. Samuel Salas, folks. He conducts the class in Spanish, right? And we're making minimal inroads in this, as far as what I could tell. I mean, as far as the hits and the numbers that the Spanish classes have been receiving, certain percentage is going up from Mexico. Okay, did you all right with that, sir? All right, good.
There are
45
views for the Spanish class.
Yeah. So the percentage, and so we're out there, and we realize you're out there. We acknowledge that you're out there. We wanna hear from you, and we wanna reach out and touch you, so to speak, and we wanna address the questions and the issues that's burning in your mind, Did you want to say something right quick, Dr. Samuel?
Yes, I'd like to have the address because she requests for material.
Yeah, I'll give you all of that. That's okay. No problem. I'll get that to you. It was somebody else that was, that had asked me about that. That's when I asked about your number. Okay. So yeah, we want to hear from you, so that we can reach out and brotherly love and see. We also realize that the internet is just the ends to a means. Sure, I mean, many of us are separated by time and distance, you know, and it's a good convenience, you know, and like somebody like in, across the country can watch what we're watching. And by the same token, you know, I watch all the other, you know, classes and stuff, and where their locales at. But the whole thing is also that you have to assemble together. You have to meet, you know. The scriptures have never failed to assemble yourselves. And there are assemblies that do happen throughout the year. I know a couple of them that I intend to go to. One is in Chicago and the other one's in Florida. Okay. And I think, you know, it should be, you know, you should try to attend if you can. You know, that way you meet brother, you know, in person. You know, the electronics and the marvels of today is wonderful. I mean, I ain't got no problems with it. I mean, we're using it. You know, but again, it's just a means to an end. Okay? I want to say something else, I guess. I just wanted to say that because, you know, we got this new camera here. We're just trying to move on into new territory for our class and to the live broadcast. And I don't know, you want to say something, Joe, about the history of, you know, what we've done? You know, he was slightly skeptical at first, but then I think in time, man, everybody saw. You see, the thing about it is, we've done it so long, everybody just got used to being in a video class, you know, being, you know, you're being videotaped. You know, it was just a normal thing. We go to Ontario class, oh yeah, but they got a camera. You know, so. So we're used to it. We have people that have grown up under the camera, okay? You know, so forth and so on. Okay, I'm through with that. Are there any questions, any comments, anything anybody would like to say or bring up?
So it's live on YouTube, or?
What's going on?
It's live on YouTube?
Yeah, as far as what we want to do, yeah, we want to go live. Not now, but I mean.
You're working on it.
Yeah, right. We have a new camera here right now. We're still making DVDs, but we're gonna go live. Yeah, okay. Come like this. Yeah, I know you can't go that fast, but I mean you can go a little faster. Yeah. We want to broadcast live, definitely. Yeah, that's, you know, just like many of the others, and the record that will be on YouTube will be the record of the video.
All right. Okay.
See, because after that, I'm not gonna be making DVDs anymore. Now LeBron says he has a process by which he can download and make it. So now, if he wants to do that, I'll abrogate that duty to him.
Gotcha.
And but I guess I'm retiring in that sense. But then I would like to move on and get into some other things, hopefully, you know. Like I say, the thing you guys did that Friday, you know, that was a novel concept. That was really good.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we could do something like that again, similar.
Yeah.
You know,
other
things, you know, as well. I mean, technology we have, you know, and you know, with some creative minds, you know, we could effectively convey this vision and revelation. Okay. Yes.
On the scripture lesson for today, they talk about wives be subject to your husbands, but it's not really referring that. I mean, a lot of people use that, like Christians and things, that the wife is supposed to be subject to the husband. But it's not that, not necessarily husband wife, husband, you know, that kind of thing, but more that we are all the wives to our husband, Yahshua?
Well, that's what Paul is conveying, but again, most people interpret that physically, you know, and so, you know, they say, you know, which in some cases for some Christian sects, I mean the Roman Catholic Church, you know, women aren't allowed to be priests.
Right.
See, you know, and even in some Protestant, women, you know, a woman should keep silent in the assembly, you know. Like, for example, she shouldn't have said anything to me.
Well, the Jehovah's Witnesses.
She should have kept her mouth shut.
They can't stand and speak.
You know, how dare, I'm standing up here, I'm the elder, you're going to, how dare thee?
I mean, serious, that's
how it is.
Yeah.
Some sects interpret that scripture that conservative, you know, that strongly. You know, I suffer a woman not to speak. But, you know, well, shut up. Keep your mouth, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. That kind of thing. Woman, obey me, you know. But see, but Paul's speaking spiritually. Mm-hmm. Because the true husband is the spirit that's within you. And when you come up here, see, I suffer not the woman to speak. See, that applies to me as well, especially to me if I'm standing up here on the floor, or anybody else for that matter. See, Will Williams, the wife, has to shut up. You know, has to know her place.
Right.
You know, just keep your mouth shut. You know, just let me do the talking. Let me do the talking. Okay, you know. That's what Yahweh is saying. Let me do the talking. See. Let me do the talking. You know, that's what Yahweh's saying. Let me do the talk. See? Because when I tell the story, I'm talking about Yahweh, but when I tell the story, you know, even a fool can't hear. That's what Yahweh said. You keep silent. Let me do the talking. Praise God. Now, well. Plate number 10. Let's get going. That's the fifth day of creation. Let's read out the textbook as well as the scripture. Well, when we read out the textbook, it will quote the scripture. Y'all ready?
What page? Volume 1, page 65. The creation of the fifth and sixth day. Plate number 10 illustrates the creation of living creatures of the water, fish, great whales, etc., and winged fowls that fly in the open firmament to multiply in the, on the earth on the fifth day of creation, as seen in the vision by Moses as compared to the threefold pattern of the tabernacle. Plate number 1. Beginning at the bottom of plate 10E in the outer court, we illustrate the amphibian plane, which means both in the water and upon the earth, wherein and whereupon the threefold manifestation of Yahweh begins upon the physical earth plane. Here the small inanimate creatures were formed as compared to the lifeless sacrifice on the altar in the pattern, plate 1E, like if the priest was anointed with the holy anointing oil representing the Holy Spirit before he entered the holy place, in plate 1C. So were these inanimate creatures, plate 10E, quickened by the spirit of animation, and they began animated, or living creatures as shown in plate 10C, which the waters brought forth after their kind, of moving creatures, great whales, and winged fowls after his kind, that fly in the open firmament of the heaven. The birds of many colors on the second veil, plate 10b, that fly in the open firmament are compared to the angelic figures woven on the second veil and around the four sides of the interior walls of the pattern of the tabernacle in plate 1b. Finally, shown in the holy place among these creatures with the instincts to care for their young. Finally, shown in the most holy place, plate 1a, the law of the Spirit proceeding from Yahweh imbues and establishes the kingships among these creatures with instincts to care for their young and replenish the earth, as shown in plate 10a. Each of these living creatures has a king and queen among them, as reflected by Yahshua the Messiah and Jerusalem above, which is his bride. Thus, the evening and the morning for the fifth day.
Okay. I think that's the end of that, right?
Yes.
Okay, now, we'll start at the end where we left off. We talked about the animals. See, draw a line. Because the most holy place, remember, it's a type of heaven. So the animals, see, and he mentioned, what was that one line again? It's about the kings and the queens. You can find that line in there.
Each of these living creatures has a king mm-hmm. and queen among them,
mm-hmm.
as reflected by Yahshua the Messiah and Jerusalem above, which is his bride.
And that's just a migratory pattern on this. Reflecting Yahshua and his bride, Jerusalem above, which is in the most holy place, or kingdom's land. Alright? And let's just draw a line. And if you remember, draw a line, here we got Adam and Eve up here in the garden. And if you remember, the animals was brought to the man to see what he would name them. And he named them, monkey, giraffe, elephant, dog, cat, bird, pig, cow, horse, whatever. But the thing about it was, they were brought to him two by two, or the male and the female, the king and the queen of their species. And here's the man Adam standing up here. He's a hermaphrodite, he's male and female. See, and they're the king and queen of their species, and here he is standing up there naming them. So that makes him king of kings.
Very good.
See, matter of fact, where's it at? Right down here, that's what it says, kings of kings. Okay? Draw a line. We can pull out something in the natural. Solomon. He was considered to be a king among kings. Had 700 wives, 300 concubines. Not to say that he didn't try to be like Wilt Chamberlain. But many of these marriages were political alliances. Like, for example, he would marry the sister of the Pharaoh of Egypt. So that would make the Pharaoh of Egypt his brother-in-law. That would make them partners or allies, Especially in peacetime, there would be trade. In war, they may help each other out, depending if somebody attacks them, or if you attack him, you're attacking me, and vice versa. Because that's my brother-in-law. Mm-hmm. That's family, that kind of thing, And see, the thing that Solomon would insist with, that when he did do that, that they would come at least once a year to render alms and thanksgivings unto Yahweh. That's why Solomon's temple had three courts, a court for the Jews, a court for the priests, and a court for the Gentiles. So that they could worship Yahweh as well. See? So that meant that that the Pharaoh of Egypt had to come there, and the king of whoever he was, you know, related to by marriage, they would have to come to Jerusalem once a year. So when they were all gathered up there, and here comes Solomon, he's out there greeting all these different kings and stuff, and here he is standing up there, king of kings, from a natural standpoint. You see that? That's how that goes. And see, that's the way it is in the animal kingdom. You know, you hear it all the time. You got the alpha males and all that kind of stuff, you know. Even among them, they you know, you have those that rise to the top. You know, they get all the chicks or whatever. yes.
Are all the animals translations from the way the Hebrews name?
Maybe not all of them. You know, because, I mean, we say the names now in English. I'm sure, you know, in Hebrew it's something else. I'm sure the Hebrew, you know, pronunciation of the name is something different. You know, but the principle is the same.
Yes.
Regardless. See. The manifestation will change, but the principle will remain the same. I don't know what word they had for a dinosaur, but they were back there with Adam. Not that they were scared of him or anything, you know, because we have the bones of them. They see how large they are, but the man, Dr. Kinley himself said Adam was a giant of a man.
Right.
And so was his progeny. They were giants. I'm talking about Cain and all that. Noah, you know. Stop and consider. The Ark. How tall? What is the dimensions of the Ark?
300 cubits by 50.
Give it to me in feet.
It's 1.5 feet. It's 300 is 450. 450, 75, and 45.
All right. So it's 45 feet long. 40 and 50 feet long, 75 feet wide, and it's 45 feet high. Okay. So now, how many stories are there on the ark?
Three.
There are three stories. So now, if it's 45 feet high, 45 divided by 3 is 15. So that means that each story was 15 feet, and that the door to walk in would have to be at least 15 feet tall. Why? Because how tall was the man?
15.
About 15 feet. It's about how tall the man was. 15 feet tall to walk in. See. And they were the last, the Antediluvians. Okay?
Okay. One question.
Yeah.
If the window was 1 cubit, 1.5 feet square, how it came out of there to see the dove or?
Well, I mean, that's big enough for a dove to come through. That's 18 inches square. Yeah, what's that, just a foot? That's about almost as long as this.
No, half of that.
Huh?
18. Half of that.
Yeah.
1.5 feet is half of that.
Yeah. 18
inches.
It's about
right there.
Okay.
Hardly a man can go through there.
No, the man ain't going through, but it's the dove's going through there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the dove.
Yeah, I was on a ship, you know, they had windows maybe not that big. And you are happy to get some sea breeze every now and then. But for a dove, that's for a man to stick his hand out with a dove. That's large enough for that.
Yeah, the dove is a type of spirit. And the high priest, when he went in the tabernacle, he was also 1 cubit, the opening to go to the most holy place.
18, 19, and 20.
Mm-hmm.
For the moment. This play here. This play is on the elementary chart. This is the play everybody sees all the time. And it's really concentrated because it shows Noah going out, warning the wicked, blood on their head. They're working by the sweat of their brow, water, or they're preaching, you know, about the ark, they're building for an ark, you know. Here's the angel with an angel here, type of spirit with the specifications. Here's the eight souls going into the ark. And then the windows of heaven break open, and the fountains of the deep break open. All right, and it rains 40 days, principle of 40. And then a year and 10 days later, here the ark is resting in the mountains of Ararat, and Noah's given the covenant. He makes a sacrifice. The bow is in the sky. Now this is all concentrated in one play, right? For the on the elementary chart, just to show a general principle, just an overall overview of what happened with Noah. Now here, Dr. Kinley, he drew it out. He just simply drew it out. Drew this dispensation. Now he drew this incident out. All right, here we got. Here we got Noah going out, as we said earlier. He's going out to warn the wicked, putting blood on their head. And here's Noah preparing the ark, 120 years, and his sons are out here, and they're working by the sweat of their brow, and he's getting the plans, because Noah got divine specifications, okay? And so now, here they are going into the ark, all right? It's going to rain 40 days, and they go into the ark, and they're in there 7 days.
That's right.
Before it rains.
Right.
Yeah. A lot of times we don't say that. See, and we don't say this, you know, either too much. See, we got Noah and his sons out here working, but in reality, for 120 years, for a good bulk of that, for a good 100 years, Noah had a whole bunch of people out here helping him out. Because a lot of people believe, even though the fact that it did not rain on the face of the earth, people believed. But then after a time, people just got tired. They were just saying, well, you know, what's up, Noah? I don't see that, you know. And then it just got to the point, you know, just his family believed. I mean, there were those who mocked him, you know, who didn't believe. They said, oh, man, you believe that, man? Why you believe this guy, man? It ain't never rained before, what, you know? Why would you believe this old guy? Well, you want it to rain? You want this boat to float? Well, okay, hold on for a minute. Hey, fellas, come over here. Let's help get this boat to float here, man. Come on, y'all. yeah, we're going to help you out, man. Come on, hey. Come on, help us out of here, y'all. Yeah, they were mockers, you know, just like today. You know, they were mockers. Yeah, they were mockers then, too, you know. So. And now, well, let's read this. Genesis 7 and 7.
Genesis 7 and 7. And Noah went in, had his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him into the ark because of the waters of the flood, of clean beasts and of beasts that are not clean, and of fowls and of everything that creepeth upon the earth. There went in two and two unto Noah into the ark, the male and the female, as Elohim had commanded Noah. And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. In the selfsame day entered Noah and Shem and Ham and Japheth, the sons of Noah and Noah's wife, and the three wives of his sons with them into the ark. They and every beast of their others, any beast after his kind, and all the cattle after their kind, and every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth after his kind, and every fowl after his kind, every bird of every sort. And they went in unto Noah into the ark, two and two of all flesh, wherein is the breath of life. And they that went in male and female of all flesh, as Elohim commanded him, and Yahweh shut him in. And the flood was 40.
Okay, let's stop right there. Okay. They said, yeah, read that verse again.
And they went in, male and female of all flesh, as Elohim had commanded him, and Yahweh shut him in.
Okay. Let's look at that right there. All right, now, we just showed you them going into the ark, going into the door, which is likened to the door of the tabernacle. All right, they're in the ark. All right, we didn't read it, but they do have provisions on here, which means they have bread. The window, see, that would be the light for the ark, okay? Now, up here, they got in, and all the animals in, and Elohim shuts the door of the ark. Why? Because see, it's still an opening here, just like, because we're at the veil position here. Just like the Jordan River opened up for them. And Elohim opened the Jordan, and Elohim closed the Jordan. Just like Elohim opened the door, and Elohim closed the door. Okay? And see, we got this cloud here. It says Elohim shuts the door, see? And look, the ark. See, it was pitched black. It was darkness line and pitched with black. It was, you know, pitch. Pitch is black. Mm-hmm. That's what the color is, see. And it's a type of Elohim. See, you even say it's a type, even in this case, it's a type of the cloud. Because when the rains come and everything, and it gets dark, and you see, because we're going to come over here, and it gets dark, except for the light in the window, you wouldn't be able to see the ark.
That's right.
One more thing.
I didn't get it.
Because the ark is dark, it's black, during the storm, you know, when it rained 40 days and 40 nights and the storm, you know, it's dark. So you wouldn't be able to see the ark.
Okay.
Unless somebody opened the window for the light to see the light come out the ark, you wouldn't be able to see it. But back over here, it says now, it says, get Revelations 3 and 8, because this is the corollary to what we just read with Noah, because we just read that Elohim shut the door. Elohim closed, you know, shut him in.
Revelations 3 and 8. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door.
Uh-huh.
And no man can shut it.
And no man can shut it.
But thou hast a little strength.
That's good enough. Said no man can shut, saving he the one that opened it. That's the one who can shut it. That's the same way with Noah's Ark, with the door here at Noah's Ark. Okay. Now, go back to Genesis. Now, as you go back to that, now here we got the fountains of the deep being broken up.
17. And the flood was 40 days upon the earth.
All right, now here, see, now look here. The fountains of the deep are broken up. And here's the human beings, they're drowned. That's a death of mankind. Mm-hmm. And they're all buried or immersed. Elohim immersed all flesh in the flood. All right. And here's the ark. It's on, moving on top of the face of the waters. It's really like the spirit of Elohim moving on the face of the deep. Mm-hmm. Okay? And it rained for 40 days and 40 nights as the ark moved on the waters. Okay? Read.
And the waters increased and bare up the ark and now, it was lifted up.
Now, so then, now, in other words, the ark ascended. It is ascending. Mm-hmm. Read.
And the waters increased and bare up the ark, and it was lifted up above the earth.
And the ark was exalted above the earth, meaning it was above, even above the mountains. Read.
And the waters prevailed, and were increased greatly upon the earth, and the ark went upon the face of the waters. And the waters prevailed exceedingly upon the earth, and all the high hills that were under the whole heaven were covered. 15 cubits upward did the waters prevail, and the mountains were covered. And all flesh died that moved upon the earth, both of fowl and of cattle and of beasts, and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth and every man.
Okay, now see, because why? We just now come back down here. See, it says, Elohim immersed all flesh. Let's just draw a line. Draw a line. Because we see, we started off with plate 10, the fifth day. Here's the spirit animation. See, that animated everything. See? Now here's Elohim deanimating everything. First, is, see, the spirit, see, because they were, they started off dead because they were in their formation. So they started off in a dead-like state, and then they were animated. Now, come back over here, everything here is now deanimated and has gone back into a dead-like state. Okay? But now it said that the ark was exalted. I think it said 15 cubits?
Yeah.
Yes.
How many, how much is that in feet? 15 cubits? 15 is 15 times 18 inches.
20
cubic, a foot and a half, right?
18 inches, yeah. 18
inches.
Yeah. So it'll be 15 times 18 inches.
Mm-hmm.
270
feet.
270
inches.
270 inches. How many feet is that?
22.5 feet.
Yeah, about 15 feet. Wait a minute. What is it?
22.5 feet.
Okay, what are you telling me about 15 for? 15 cubits. Okay, 15 cubits is equal to 22.5 feet. Right.
Right.
Okay. So it was 25.2 feet above the mountains. It says 15 cubits above the mountains, okay, so. I'm just curious because, see, in a boat, no, I'll take that back. Because it was really a flat boat. It shouldn't have been, structurally, it shouldn't have floated. But it did. See?
Why?
Well, not that, not floated, but I mean, it wasn't so much, it's not navigatable, I'll put it like that. It wasn't made to be navigated. It didn't, I don't read anywhere where it has a rudder.
Oh, yeah.
Or a steering wheel.
Yeah, they had no motors.
You know.
they don't have a place to go.
You know? So, I mean, you know, again, well, hey, other folks made, don't you think these folks made boats? They had their own boats. People were saying, like, shoot, let me get the, you know. And yet, it's still, you know, it was a deluge. Because, see, the fountains of the deep broke open. Wait for that. Second day. Let's just look at that.
Genesis 7 and 11.
See, and then here we got the wicked destroyed. That's a death. Bring it over this way. Yeah, right there, so fine. Figure of baptism. And then here, let's keep reading.
22. All in whose nostrils was the breath of life of all that was in the dry land died. And every living substance was destroyed which was upon the face of the ground, both man and cattle, and the creeping things, and the fowl of the heaven. And they were destroyed from the earth, and Noah only remained alive, and they that were with him in the ark. And the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days.
Okay, and the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days. Mm-hmm. All right, 150 days. See, that's the antediluvian age ended by flood. All right? Mm-hmm. Now, if you remember, the flood was in the 600th year of Noah's life, mm-hmm. and it happened, find it, 7-11.
In the 600th year of Noah's life,
uh-huh.
In the second month, the 17th day of the month,
in the 17th day of the month.
The same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were open.
Now, looking at it according to the Hebrew calendar that was given to Moses, right? The first month is
April,
which corresponds to the English month of
April.
So if the first month is April, then the second month,
May,
according to the English month, would be May.
Mm-hmm.
So we know that the flood happened on May the 17th, and we have the year right here. May the 17th, 2348 BBY. Okay? All right, keep that in mind. All right? Now, that's when that happened here. All right, so now here, we got the wicked destroyed, the earth is inundated with water, all right, a figure of baptism. And then here we got this raven being let down. Maybe we need to get to that part. Keep reading.
And Elohim remembered Noah and every living thing and all the cattle that was with him in the ark. And Elohim made a wind to pass over the earth, and the waters assuaged. The fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained.
Okay, let's hold it for a minute. Now, I had this plate brought up here to show you that according to the second day of Moses' vision, the waters above was separated from the waters beneath. And a firmament was put in the midst, right, that separated the two volumes of water. Alright? All Yahweh did was just take away the firmament and the waters came together. Mm-hmm. The fountains of the deep broke open and the waters gushed forward, and the windows of heaven rent and, opened up and the waters came down. Well, in other words, the veils was written twain, and the waters came through. And see, meaning in the midst.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Draw a line. But in the midst of this is the ark. See? Alright? Just like right here. See, according to the second day, you got this spirit, see, moving across the face of the deep. It's spirit law, that is. See, spirit law, see, this is what people are not getting. See, these plates descend and ascend. Because spirit law, see, when you see this here, spirit law, what you're looking at is spirit law transmuting into whatever it is you're looking at on this day. That's spirit law. That's him manifesting himself as whatever, in this case, the second day, manifesting himself as the waters above, the waters beneath, and the firmament in the midst. Okay? Keep reading.
And the waters returned from off the earth continually, and after the end of the 150 days, the waters were abated. And the ark rested in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, upon the mountains of Ararat.
Okay, now see, that's it. Now, after 150 days. All right, see, now the waters rising, and the ark rising with the waters, that's a type of a resurrection. Alright, and it said after, and they reached their height, because we saw it over here, after 150 days. Now if you remember, we kind of went over this in a workshop about 150. Remember when we talked about the 153 fish?
Mm-hmm.
See, Yahshua Messiah fulfilled that by doing three Pentecosts in his ministry, which is 50, and then his death, burial, resurrection, 3 days in the heart of the earth. But see here, you see the same thing in principle, 150 back here. See? Correlate that 150 with this 150. Alright? That's all I'm doing. Just showing the repetition of that. Alright? Keep reading.
Five, and the waters decreased continually until the 10th month. in the 10th month on the first day of the month were the tops of the mountains seen.
Mm-hmm.
And it came to pass at the end of 40 days that Noah opened the window of the ark which he had made.
Mm-hmm.
And he sent forth a raven which went forth to and fro until the waters are dried up from off the earth.
Now see, the raven went out to and fro and didn't come back. Why? It's a type of the satanic spirit being kicked out of heaven. He is kicked out and he didn't, and he went to and fro seeking who he may devour, and he didn't come back. So here's the raven doing the same thing. All right, read.
8. Also he sent forth a dove from him to see if the waters are abated from off the face of the ground.
Uh-huh.
But the dove found no rest for the sole of her foot, and she returned unto him into the ark, for the waters were on the face of the whole earth. Then he put forth his hand and took her, and pulled her in unto him into the ark.
Okay, read.
And he stayed yet other 7 days, and again he sent forth a dove out of the ark.
Uh-huh.
And the dove came in to him in the evening, and lo, in her mouth was an olive leaf plucked off.
Mm-hmm.
So Noah knew that the waters were abated from off the earth. And he stayed yet other 7 days, and sent forth a dove which returned not again unto him any more.
Okay.
And it came to pass in the 601st year.
Okay, now see, now the dove, he did that 3 times. Let the dove out 3. Why did he do that 3 times? Well, it's all correlated.
3 trips.
How many times did the high priest go up here into the most holy place?
3 times.
See, how many times did Yahshua go out and check on his disciples in the Garden of Gethsemane?
3 times.
See, how many times did Moses go up that mountain?
3 times.
See, it's all correlated. See, that's all. Read.
And it came to pass in the 601st year, in the first month, the first day of the month, the waters were dried up from off the earth,
mm-hmm.
and Noah removed the covering of the ark and looked, and behold, the face of the ground was dry. And in the second month, on the 720th day of the month, was the earth dry.
Okay, now, let's note that. In the 601st year of Noah's life, in the second month, in the 27th day, all right? So now this lets you know, with a little arithmetic, how long the flood was. That's 1 year right here. This cancels each other out. 17 from 27, 10 days. The flood lasted for 1 year and 10 days. Okay? Now, get Daniel 9:24.
Years are determined upon thy people,
mm-hmm.
and upon thy holy city, to restrain transgression and make an end of sin offering, and to make atonement for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to complete the prophetic vision, and to anoint the holy place. Know therefore and understand.
That's good enough. All right, 70 weeks of years. That simply means this: 70 times 7. Which equals to 490.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Which is a cycle, which is a principle. It's perfection times itself. Perfection in operation, actually. Okay? Now, if that be the case, see, then we have to see these principles in operation. Now, we already know that Noah preached for 120 years, right? We know that, do we?
Yes.
Okay. And we just told you that the flood lasted for 1 year
and
10 days. Now, 1 year, prophetically speaking, is how many days?
360.
360 days.
Mm-hmm.
And then we got 10 days lagged over, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so when we add that together,
that's 490 years in principle, or not 490 days, or 490 years in principle, with the flood. Okay? Now, if that be the case, we already know Noah was 600 years old when the flood happened, correct?
Right.
How many years did he preach?
120.
He preached 120 years, which means he was 480 years old when he began to preach.
Mm-hmm.
How many generations is Adam? Is Noah from Adam?
10.
He's 10 generations from Adam. 10th generation. So when you add 10 onto Noah, that's 490. With Noah, the principle, 490. Okay? Now, get the textbook, first volume, it's page 7.
Well, the importance of what divided as 7, dispensations and ages.
Is it 7, maybe 9?
I think you want 9.
It's the genealogy, that's what I want.
Okay, that would be page 9 is what you want. It's actually 8, but you want me to start at 9? Or says the persons involved in the transmission?
Let me see.
Or the run the leaf concerning the sacred record.
Yeah, page 9. Yeah, I don't want the whole thing. I just want an excerpt.
Alright.
I just want an excerpt. Okay. Yeah, just start to read that.
The persons involved in the transmission of the sacred records, according to their theory, would be the following. 1. Adam, the first earthly created man, whose wife was Eve, whose total lifespan was 930 years, begat Cain and Abel and other sons and daughters. Seth, the son of Adam, was born in the 130th year of Adam's life. The total lifespan of Seth was 912 years. Enoch, 7 generations from Adam, was born in the 622nd year after the creation of Adam and translated in the year 987.
Okay, that's what I needed to hear. He was translated in the year 987.
Does that mean died?
Just wait a minute. He was translated in the year 987 AM. See, that means this. How long did Adam live?
930 years.
He lived 930 years. All right. Page 17. Let me show it to you first before I calculate it. Enoch, born 7th from Adam. There's a death decree out here. There's a death decree. Did y'all know that?
Mm-hmm.
How do y'all know that?
The persecution of...
How do you know that?
I'm like
Sergeant Carter of Gomer Power.
According to the migration trick, there's a death decree down there.
There's a death decree, sure enough. But why is there a death decree? Before there was a migration trick, what happened back here that let you know there was a death decree?
He was being persecuted by... No.
Now you gotta... What started it? Go back to the beginning of it. What started the persecution?
Well, from Cain.
Yeah, from Cain and Abel.
Back here in the garden. What was said to the woman?
Thou shalt be saved in childbearing.
What was said? What was said to the serpent?
Shall we eat dust of the...
The bruise thy head and...
I shall bruise thy head, I shall bruise his head. In other words, there's going to be, I will put, oh,
enmity between you and your seed.
Thank you. So that enmity passed on. See, look, let's read it, because I gotta go back to a crash course of antediluvian philosophy here. What does it say?
And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. He shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
All right, now, did you think Elohim was fitting when he said that? See, that's why. Genesis 6 and 5.
And Yahweh saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every tenth of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually.
Mm-hmm.
And he repented Yahweh that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. And Yahweh said, I will destroy man,
mm-hmm.
from whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping things, and the birds of the heavens, for it repented me that I have made them.
Verse 11.
The earth was corrupt before Elohim, and the earth was filled with violence.
It was filled with violence. What kind of violence?
Open hatred.
See, that's the question. What kind of violence? Just wanton violence? That's just, you know... Just people, you know, just going, no. What kind of violence was down here in Egypt?
Bondage.
They was killing the boy babies, two and under.
Death decree.
Birth control.
Reproduction.
See, birth control. Remember, we're dealing with the satanic spirit, the mystery of iniquity here. Mm-hmm. His thing is birth control.
Mm-hmm.
Violence. Come over here. Look here. Enoch. Where is Enoch being born at? Look where he's born.
A cave.
He's in a cave. He's hidden.
Mm-hmm.
That's the burial principle. He's hidden.
Mm-hmm.
There's a death decree, and he's hidden in the cave, and here's a dove showing for the Spirit. The Holy Spirit. On Enoch. Okay? Now, here we are, Enoch prophesied. Here we got Lamech and his two wives. Okay? Now, when Enoch prophesied, look where we're located at. What compartment are we in?
Holy place.
We're in the holy place. All right? And see, here he is 50 years. See, this is 50 years after the death of Adam. Remember in the textbook, he said, it was read that he was translated in the year 987 AM.
Mm-hmm.
See, this year, this would be the year 980. And this is, let me put it up here. No, I put it up. Here's Adam. He lived 930 years. Here's Enoch. In the holy place, that illustration. He's 50 years after the death of Adam. Now the 980, that's the year 980 AM. 980 happens to be 2 times 490. So when he prophesied, and look, Enoch prophesied the end of that age. He prophesied it on a year of a 490 cycle. Okay? Now, if that be the case, now, of course, Enoch preceded Noah. All right? So these two cycles came first, then Noah preached with his life, and then the flood came. Right? Mm-hmm. How many cycles do we have up here?
Four.
One, two, three, four. Mm-hmm. We have four cycles, correct? So four times 490 equals 1960. And 1960, when that number comes up, the end of the antediluvian age. Remember, we did this a little while back, a couple lessons back, about the 1960 and the present age. It has to be consistent. Each age in the realm of time has to end in 1960, in principle. In the present age, there are four 490 cycles in the post-Diluvian age, even though that age lasted 2,377 years, but in principle it ended in 1960 because there's four cycles, or 490 cycles in. Here you got four 490s in principle. This age only lasted 1,656 years, but in principle it's got to end in 1960. Has to end in 1960. That's what we're showing you here. Now the complete Enoch, 50 years after the death of Adam, we showed you over here. He prophesied, and then 7 years later, Enoch was translated. All right? Mm-hmm. Yahshua fulfilled that. Because see, remember, Yahshua came to pick up Adam where he fell. So when his 3 days, death, burial, resurrection, and then 50 days later, Pentecost,
yes.
See, that translated, that was a fulfillment of Enoch, because Enoch was translated. Mm-hmm. On the day of Pentecost, the Jews, the 120 in the upper room, they were translated. Mm-hmm. And then 7 years later, the Gentiles were translated. Just like 7 years later, Enoch was translated. You guys played it the other night. Dr. Kinley said it best. You must make these correlations, for you, mm-hmm. or else you must remain a skeptic. You must engage these charts. And when I say that, you are engaging the vision. Because that's the only way you're going to find out what the purpose is, by engaging the charts. See? There's nothing wrong with exhortation. Nothing wrong with that. Personal testimonies, nothing wrong with that. But don't let that be your stock in trade. This is a school. And we do have a curriculum. The curriculum is this vision. This is what you should really try to understand and learn it. And try to, yeah. This is what you have to eat. This is what you must engage. You must do this. And when you do, we've shown time and time again the things that when you do, things come out that we never even thought about. Hadn't even imagined. Say, oh wow, we didn't think about that. Certain things that come up. This is what our founder wanted. He laid the groundwork. He most certainly did. He laid the groundwork, showed the lessons, wrote two books, as he would say. I wrote two books. To give you instructions on how to do this so that you can do this yourself and look within to see the power that is within. See? Right. Did we leave off anywhere?
You get the
eight in the ark.
Eight in the ark. The figure First Ms. will get it. 1 Peter 3 and 20. It's up there. Ms. will read it. This is what Dr. Kinley wanted us to do. To take the time and walk through the scriptures using these charts and the tabernacle pattern. So that we could see, as he saw, how the scriptures didn't read the same anymore. Yes, go ahead.
But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day with Yahweh is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day.
Is that 3 and 20?
3 and 20.
No, 1
Peter 3 and 20, which some
time
were disobedient.
Yeah, 1 Peter 3 and 20.
When once the long-suffering Elohim waited in the days of Noah, while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, 8 souls were saved by water.
Ah, yeah, that's 1 Peter 3 and 20. Okay. Now we can go back to Genesis, to Noah. I think where you left off in the 8th chapter somewhere. Maybe we can expedite. Read 9 and 1.
Genesis 9:1. And Elohim blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Mm-hmm. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered.
Okay, now hold on right there. Now we got this plate up here. See, we just had this plate. See, we're in the most holy plate on this plate. Just draw a line. Read that scripture again.
And Elohim blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth and upon all the fishes of the sea. Unto your hand are they delivered.
In other words, you're going to be a king unto them. That's the same thing. That's what he did it with Adam.
That's right. Yes.
So now he's sending the man. Said, you are, the fear of you and the dread of you will be upon all animals. Why? Because you're the king now. Mm-hmm. You're the king. When you step in there, they're going to stop and look at, man is here. You know, we got to do something. Either get up and leave or defend our territory or something. The man is here. Now we're all at risk now. The man is here. The man. As can you imagine animals saying it? Oh, the man. Read.
3. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you, even mm-hmm. as the green herb which I have given you all things. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall you not eat. Mm-hmm. And surely your blood of your lives will I require, at the hand of every beast will I require it. And at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother, will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of Elohim made he man. And you be fruitful and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and multiply therein. And Elohim spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, and I, behold, I establish my covenant with you, and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you, neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And Elohim said, this is the token of the covenant which I made between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh.
Okay, go ahead, read.
and that us both shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between Yahweh and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth.
Okay, good enough. All right, here's the bow here, which is a rainbow, which is, what is a rainbow?
A spectrum.
It's a spectrum. See, seven prismatic colors, right? Let's draw a line. See, that would be like the flash of the Shekinah. Because that's Elohim. See, Elohim is, come over here. I have to find it, but I remember in that one book about astronomy, the way they used to do this was, here's Elohim here, and he would be like a prism, a glass prism, and as the light shines through the prism, it breaks off into seven prismatic colors. Where here, you see Elohim here, and he's the light, and it's passing through, so to speak, and he's breaking off into 7 days of creation. See, because seven denotes perfection, and that's what Elohim is. And so the rainbow denotes Elohim, Elohim in the cloud. The rainbow in the cloud is the same as over here on the Day of Atonement when the high priest did his duty as far as flicking the blood. After that 21st flick of blood, Elohim would see a vision of Elohim in the cloud. Not just this cloud, but also in the cloud of his consciousness. Okay? All right. Any questions, comments, anything?
Yeah, I was wondering what translate meant.
What?
Translate. They say so-and-so was translated. Does that mean converted?
Yes. Now you see him, now you don't. Simple as that.
What?
Now you see him, now you don't.
Translate means to convey into heaven without seeing death.
No, that's not what it means. It means converted from what, changing one form to another. Because see, Enoch, he was translated, but he did not go to heaven.
What was he translated into?
He was taken off. The body was just taken off. His physical body just disappeared.
And that's it.
His physical body disappeared. But he was not conveyed into heaven. And see, and since we're on that subject, you may as well bring in Elijah. Because that's real, real flowery imagery, horses and a white chariot, taking him up into the heavens, so to speak, atmospheric heaven. And so people think that, but they're not. They're not in heaven, because Yahshua, when he walked on, he said, ain't no man came down from heaven, ain't no man been to heaven, say he didn't came down from heaven, who is in heaven, as he was walking around in the flesh.
Right.
Meaning that, it would have to be that way. Because see, he's the first fruits to rise. If anybody's going to be, he's going to go to heaven first before any of these folks do. Mm-hmm. Because what is heaven? Really?
State.
Right. It's not a geographical place. It's a state or a condition. Mm-hmm. See, Enoch and Elijah, they were translated out of the flesh, but they were not translated into the kingdom. In other words, they were not translated into his body. They may have had the Holy Spirit. Now they did have that. The Holy Spirit did operate through both of them, without question. But because it was before his death, burial, resurrection, the Holy Spirit did not remain. See, that's the difference. Even Moses, who was born with the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit did not remain because he messed up. He disobeyed. But that was according to a purpose. Because the scripture says, there are none righteous, no, not one.
Right.
Even those that had the Holy Spirit under the dispensation of the law and even before. Okay. What does it say? What's it say on the machine?
I'm looking. Here?
Yeah, what's it say on
the machine? I got the 134.
1 hour, 34 minutes. So I got about 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Their translation is a type and shadow of our translation in the spirit. See, we're translated now so that we won't see death, not physical death, but the spiritual death, which is the true death. That's why I always harp about the thing about, you know, about where you're going when you die. You know? Well, listen, let me tell you something. You better be in heaven now before you die. Or else, you know, you ain't going nowhere. Either way. If you're carnal-minded and you take off the flesh when you're carnal-minded, guess what?
You will still
be carnal-minded after the flesh. Ergo, you didn't go anywhere. But if you're in Yahshua while you're in the flesh, when you take off the flesh, you'll still be in Yahshua. Therefore, you still ain't going nowhere, but you will have taken off this flesh. But the thing of it is, you have to be translated now while you're in this mortal coil. You want to say something, John?
And where was Enoch when he was translated?
Where was what?
Enoch. Where was Enoch and Elijah when they were translated?
What do you mean, where were they? Where were their souls?
Yeah.
Where were their souls? Their souls. Okay. I will tell you where their souls were at. Well, I won't, but the scripture will. Samuel, 1 Samuel, First Samuel 28 and 11.
1 Samuel 28:11. Then said the woman,
I'm cutting this up. Now Saul, he's consulting on, you know, this is a very famous story, the Witch of Endor, a medium, a soothsayer, you know, seance, channeling, as they call it now. Somebody to make contact with the spirits of the dead on the other side, all right? Now, if you've ever dealt with it, the game is simply this. You really can't contact your loved ones. But see, but demons use these opportunities to contact you by imitating your loved ones. And they know everything about your loved ones. Everything. Everything. See? And so this is what they do to come through to deceive and trick and so forth and so on, which is what this woman is trying to do here. But read quickly.
28:11. Then said the woman, whom shall I bring up unto thee? And he said, bring me up Samuel.
Mm-hmm.
And when the woman saw Samuel, she cried with a loud voice. And the woman spoke to Saul, saying, why hast thou deceived me? For thou art Saul.
Mm-hmm.
And the king said unto her, be not afraid, for what sawest thou? And the woman said unto Saul, I saw
say spirits.
Spirits descend out of the earth. And he said unto her, what form is he of? And she said, an old man cometh up, and he is covered with a mantle. And Saul perceived that it was Samuel, and he stooped with his face to the ground and bowed himself. And Samuel said to Saul, why hast thou disquieted me?
Why hast thou disquieted me?
To bring me up.
To bring me up. What? Bring me up from where?
And Saul answered, I am sore distressed, for the Philistines made war against me.
Wait a minute. Disquieted me and bring me up. We haven't dealt with that yet. How was he disquieted? What do you do when you disquiet somebody? If I came and disquieted you, Reggie, what would you have been doing? More than likely, you probably would have been asleep. Mm-hmm. And then I come up, you were in a quiet state. And then I came along and woke you up. I disturbed your quiet. I disquieted you. Therefore, Samuel was sleeping. Why? Because this is before the death, burial, resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. This is still under the dispensation of, this is still in the post-Diluvian age, and it's still under the dispensation of the law. So therefore, these folks are sleeping, disquieting me.
Why? Because they're in there alive, and they're waiting for the trump to sound at the last day for them, which would be Yahshua the Messiah, resurrecting. Because when he resurrected, he sounded the trump, then they'll be disquieted in a good way. They'll wake up and follow him into the city and be awake forevermore.
Didn't John say that in Revelations? Something about their sleep underneath his feet?
Well, let's read that.
Somewhere in John.
That's the sixth, the fifth angel, fifth seal in Revelations.
Chapter 9.
The fifth angel?
What does it say?
And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven.
The fifth seal?
That's the fifth angel.
Fifth seal?
That's what I asked you.
I said fifth seal. I've been saying fifth seal. I don't know where you got angel from.
King James.
That's what it's, no, it's got, it's the fifth seal. Let's ask, is it the ninth chapter, the 96?
Well, that's fifth seal. I'm not sure. I think I'm not sure.
The opening of the seals.
I think you want 6 and 9, right?
9 and 6 or 6 and 9?
I think it's like 6 and 9, right?
Yeah, 6 and 9. 6 and 9. That's
right. And when he had opened the fifth seal,
yes,
I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of Yahweh and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Yahweh, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? And white robes were given unto them, and white robes were given unto every one of them, and was said unto them that they should rest yet for a little season, and to the full number of their fellow servants also, and their brethren that should be killed as they were, should be completed.
Okay, now, here we are, right here. Alright. And here's Jerusalem. Now, the way Dr. Kinney's got this illustrated, and he's got Jerusalem here, and he's got the woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet here. And see him and just draw a line. See, we just read about the altar of incense. About the altar. This is the altar of incense that it's talking about right here. Under the altar. See, how long? See how long? And see, not long, because see, they were resurrected and they walked into Jerusalem. Okay? And they are resting. They're not asleep, but they're resting in Jerusalem, in Yahshua. See? If you ever get a chance, if you can find it, find Richard Davis' testimony. Richard Davis was a man who was in a very bad motorcycle accident. And through the power of Dr. Kinley, through the power of Yahweh, healed him. But he tells a story about when he was in that state between life and death. Mm-hmm. And he talks about how he was enveloped, you know, in a cloud, so to speak. And he just felt so good, you know, he just felt so wonderful being there. And then when he was taken out, he was brought back, you know, to the living. He said that he asked Dr. Kinley, why didn't you, he said, boss, why didn't you bring me back? And Dr. Kinley said, I needed a witness. Needed a witness. But see, he was at rest inside that cloud. Now, others, if you're not in Yahshua, when you die, you are asleep. But let's look at the natural as a type. When you go to sleep in the natural, what's one of the things you do when you sleep?
Dream.
You dream.
Nightmare.
Or nightmare. But you dream.
Yeah, it's still a dream.
The same way with people when they die. When they die, they're asleep physically in the sense of that, but they're living out their lives.
Right.
As they know it, mm-hmm. See, if you know, I'll use my old man as an example. You know, he liked, he was a clothes horse, but he also liked to go hunting and fishing. And looking good, you know, go out on the town and look good. I imagine if he didn't know anything about Yahweh, that's all. That's all he's dreaming about, so to speak. That's what he's living. Because see, you whenever you go into the grave, that's all you take. I mean, that's all you know. If that's all you know, what else you gonna, you know? Now Yahweh can appear to you any way he wants. See, and really, a lot of times when you have these near-death experiences, Satan's still trying to get to you. Even at the point of death, he can still appear unto you as an angel of light.
That's correct.
Even at the point of death. How would you know the difference? Without the Holy Spirit, you wouldn't know the difference. If you didn't really know anything about gold, somebody could bring you some fool's gold, iron pyrite, and fool you with it. Mm-hmm. How would you know? Reminds me of that show, Quiet Chain Kings. Kung Fu, you know, it's an old guy who got mad at him. Why didn't you tell me this wasn't gold? And the guy just looked at him and said, what do I know of gold? You know? You don't know the difference. See? How would you? Not without. And listen, the pattern is Elohim. The pattern is Yahshua. That's why Dr. Kinley taught this. Your knowledge of the pattern, I'll read it. Isaiah 33 and 6, is it? Or is it 8?
You said it right, 6.
33 and 6.
Isaiah 33 and 6. And wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times.
Let's try it again.
And wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times and strength of salvation.
All right.
The fear of Yahweh is his treasure.
Now wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times and the strength of your salvation. Wisdom and knowledge of what? This pattern. Mm-hmm. That's why Dr. Kinley always said, you must make these correlations. Because in doing so, you increase your wisdom and your knowledge. And that increases your stability and gives you your strength of your salvation. The pattern is Yahshua. Your knowledge of the pattern is the Holy Spirit. A lot of people don't like to think that, you know, they want to keep it to a feeling. Oh, I can feel, you know, my faith is dead. No, it's wisdom and knowledge shall be the, you know, stability of thy times and the strength of your salvation. Want to say so?
Yeah. Yahshua said when he went to resurrect Lazarus, they said he was dead. And he said, he's asleep. We said he's asleep. And he was able to call him and resurrect him from that state that he was in. But he said he ain't dead, but he's asleep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's what they were prior to that. See, because they didn't, you know. See, that's what they were the spirits in prison. See, they were, you read in the scripture lesson, didn't you? The scripture lesson, read that, about the spirits in prison?
Yeah.
See, they were asleep. See, Yahshua, see, the Holy Spirit, through these dispensations, preached to the spirits in prison.
1 Peter 3:18, for Yahshua had suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to Elohim, being put to death in the flesh and quickened by the Spirit, by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison.
By which also he preached to the spirits in prison. When did he do that? Through these dispensations. Mm-hmm. For 4,000 years. Preaching to the spirits in prison. And then when they died in the faith, like Job or Abraham or Noah or Enoch, Adam, you know, Solomon, Jeremiah, when they all died in the faith, Yahshua, when he resurrected, they resurrected right along with him. Mm-hmm. And walked into the city. I got to add this up here, sir. Right here. They walked right into the city. See, well, they were under this altar. Mm-hmm. See? But let's not forget, the veils are rent. So this compartment and this compartment are one. And really, you are, look, if you are in Jerusalem, then you have, you come here, Galatians 3:21, and we'll be right over. See, this is where spirit law is at. This is where Elohim is. See?
Galatians 3:21.
Uh-huh.
Is the law then against the promises of Yahweh?
3:21?
Yeah, that's 3:21.
Or is it 4:21?
Tell me.
Yes, come on, tell me.
Tell me, ye that desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, mm-hmm. the one by a bondmaid, the other by a free woman.
Mm-hmm.
But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise.
Mm-hmm.
Which things are an allegory, for these are the two covenants. The one from the Mount Sinai was genereth to bondage.
Genereth to bondage. The one from Mount Sinai. See, that genereth to bondage, read.
Which is Agar.
Which is Hagar, read.
And this Agar is Mount Sinai in Arabia.
Mount Sinai in Arabia.
And answereth to Jerusalem, which now is, mm-hmm. and is in bondage with her children.
Read.
But Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all.
Uh-huh.
For it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not, break forth and cry, thou that travailest not, for the desolate hath many more children than she which hath a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise.
The children of the promise, read.
But as then, he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the Spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the Scripture?
Mm-hmm.
Cast out the bondwoman and her son, mm-hmm. for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not children of the bondwoman, but of the free.
Well, the free, which is Jerusalem, above, the most holy place. Why? Because that's a type of heaven. Type of heaven. See, where spirit law is. Where everything, where Yahshua. See, Yahshua is in the bosom of the Father. That's this. That's spirit law right here. See, and we are in Yahshua.
So is this why Israel thinks they should have had all the land because of what it says here? Cast out the bondwoman and your son? Ishmael?
Well, perhaps. Yeah.
But didn't he mean for them to share it? He said that Ishmael shall also have...
Well, there are Israeli Arabs there. The thing is, they live under the rules of the Israeli government, but the Palestinians, see, they want their own state. See, that's the difference. So now...
Seems like they shouldn't have their own state.
Well, it's a long history behind that, you know. When two brothers fight over something, you know, sometimes, you know, it just never gets resolved. What's the term being used? What's the term called? Rival sons. You know, that's what you got sometimes. You got rival sons, you know. You know, trying to win daddy's love, you know, trying to prove that, you know, prove to daddy, I'm the one, daddy. I'm the one you should invest, you know, thing in. I'm your true son. I'm the one holding up your name, your honor, et cetera, et cetera. You know, so. Anyway, thank you for coming out. Thank you for you folks out there always watching. We love to hear from you, you know. We're pushing toward live, and we'll get there, you know. I'll be at a turtle's pace, but we'll definitely get there. And with those few words, thank you much.
Thank you for that.
Okay, that concludes tonight's lectures. Any announcements? No announcements. We have classes here Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Fridays 7:30 to 9:30. Every fourth Sunday of the month, we have a Spanish class. Now, next month is a short month. Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got to figure out when we're going to have a Spanish class. Okay, let's all stand. All the nations can be headed by Dr. Reginald Thomas. Okay. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy. To the one who might tell him our Savior, Yahshua, our sovereign, in our glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever, as all say.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It'll be the fourth Sunday, February 6th.
What is it?